McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents Get Funded, the Startup Entrepreneur's Guide to Seriously Successful Fundraising by John Biggs and Eric Villines. Narrated by B.J. Harrison. Publisher's Note: This audiobook refers to figures and tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Introduction. This book is about building businesses. There are plenty of books about creating a lean startup and building the perfect product, but there are no books that will provide you with a step-by-step guide on how to choose the best funding strategy, pitch investors, and build the perfect deck, as well as tell you how to avoid the most common pitfalls that often kill new businesses. At the outset, we'd like to state the obvious. Creating a successful, cash-positive business requires a lot of work, a lot of luck, and a lot of passion. Yet even if all the stars align, even if you have the greatest idea of all time, the chance of your business not getting funded or even failing is very high. We should know. Between us, we have built 10 businesses and made or raised $30 million. I, John, have written about more than 8,000 small businesses for TechCrunch, many of which followed the traditional funding model and lived or died by their bank accounts. I, Eric, have spent more than 20 years working with entrepreneurs and Fortune 500 executives on go-to-market strategies, as well as preparing them for public speaking, media interviews, investor meetings, and more. According to research firm Fundera, 20% of small businesses fail in the very first year. What is the number one reason these businesses fail? Almost half of all startups close up before they are ever able to find a viable market for their product or service. In the beginning, the primary source of most cash flow is going to be through funding. But if the business runs out of funding before it can begin making its own positive cash flow, then everything will stop. This is why many people will tell you that starting a business is crazy. But if you are anything like us, or the many entrepreneurs we know, then you probably have an idea that you are truly passionate about. You want to do something amazing, something useful, something that might just change the world, or perhaps a small corner of the world in which you live. And there is not a damn thing that's going to stop you. If this is how you feel, then please keep listening. So yes, starting a business takes heaps of work, a lot of luck, and passion. But it also takes funding. How to think about startup funding. When we say funding, we mean any money that keeps a business alive. This money can come in any of a bewildering variety of forms from myriad sources, subject to a vast number of considerations. There's debt, there's equity, there are angels and VCs and convertible notes. There are dilutions and valuations and crowdsourcing and initial crypto coin offerings. There are rounds and raises, Series A, Series B, Series XYZ, venture debt, and Small Business Administration, or SBA loans. Not to mention the perennial favorite, friends and family cash. If you don't come to this process with a strong background in startup speak, it can seem overwhelming. Two things are certain. Every source of funding comes with strings attached, explicitly or implicitly. And if a deal sounds too good to be true, it is. Get funded the right way, and with a lot of hard work and a little bit of luck, your business will prosper, you'll prosper, and your investors will too. Get funded the wrong way, and you may lose it all. Far too often, founders either watch their businesses fail or thrive from the sidelines after their investor friends have pushed them out the door. So, how do you navigate this maze? We've got you covered. How to think about startup investors. We can't emphasize enough how critical it is to understand investors, who come in as many varieties as businesses do. Only when you understand what motivates them, what they're looking for, what they have to offer, what your rights are when dealing with them, and what their rights are when it comes to you and your business, only then can you determine what kind of funding model is best for you. Every investment is a transaction. That means that both parties give something and both parties get something. Even if your mother gives you a wad of cash with no strings attached, it would be prudent to assume that there are strings of the invisible kind. That is, don't spend it all at the track. When dealing with other kinds of investors, you may need to be especially vigilant about looking for those invisible strings. That doesn't mean you should go into the process with fear in your heart, wary of everyone you meet. It just means you always need to be thinking in terms of a transaction. What am I giving up? What am I getting? What is my investor giving up? What are they getting? Make sure you know the answers to these questions before you sign on the dotted line. There are many types of investors, with many motivations and expectations. Some investors need to know only that the founders are smart, highly motivated, and full of integrity. Others will need to see a detailed prospectus with budgets and contingency plans for your first 5 years of operation. Depending on your circumstances, either one of these might be the best fit for your business. It goes without saying that if they're investing in your startup, they've got a propensity for risk-taking. A very high percentage of startups fail, and when they do, investors get nothing. All competent investors know this. Investors who are risk-averse buy treasury notes or municipal bonds, not stakes in startups out to change the world. But just because investors know there's a good chance they'll lose the money they invest in you, doesn't mean that they don't want to write a check. It's your job first to do all the preparation necessary to increase your odds of success, and second, to explain exactly how and why your new business is going to beat the odds and succeed. We'll make sure you know what your investor wants and needs to know, and we'll teach you how to communicate clearly. How to determine the right funding model for your business. Too many first-time founders stumble into their financing. This is understandable. If you're starting, say, a business selling gourmet ice cream that you make in your kitchen and sell from a tricycle, like Peter Angevine, co-founder of the successful Little Baby's Ice Cream, you may be, understandably, more concerned with the chemistry of ice cream, food safety regulations, and bicycle maintenance than you are with debt-to-equity ratios. But if your business takes off like a rocket ship, and we hope it does, it would be better to have given some thought to those ratios. Otherwise, you may find yourself in what entrepreneur Keith Teer calls the startup valley of death, at the very threshold of success, without a dollar in the bank. In that situation, you may take the first deal that comes along and wind up losing everything you have built. Here are the steps we recommend before signing any agreement and taking any money from any investor. make sure you understand your options. Decide what you're willing to give up for investment. Choose the kind of investor you want. Devise scenarios from best case to worst case. Find potential investors and talk with them without pitching them for money. Run your plan by disinterested third parties whom you trust. Decide what's best for you and your business. Design a timetable that will allow you to raise as much money as possible to support your goals. All of these bullet points lead to one simple activity. We want you to think about your bank balance. If you're not thinking about your funding strategy and how it's connected to your business, you're going to lose. How to get funded and hopefully prosper. One of the complaints we've heard from first-time founders is that it's hard, nearly impossible, to even find the people who might be willing to invest in you. TV shows like Shark Tank and Hollywood movies push the narrative that finding an investor for your young business, no matter how wonderfully it's managed or how brilliant its strategy, is a magical event that turns your life around, and the investor is a fairy godmother waving a wand of money. In our experience, that's just not true. The problem, often, is that there's a mismatch between the story you're telling and the kind of potential investor you're telling it to. Early investors don't want to hear a pitch suited for institutional investors looking for a later funding opportunity, and vice versa. Giving the wrong pitch only communicates that you don't really know what you're doing, which, we hardly need to say, is not the impression you want to give people when you're asking them for money. Preparing your story. Everyone's heard of the elevator pitch, a narrative about your startup that's so pithy, persuasive, and short that you could tell it to someone over the course of a typical ride in an elevator and win them over. We agree that you need an elevator pitch, and we'll show you how to craft yours. But an elevator pitch isn't going to get you a check for $1 million. For that, you need a story that has a little more meat on its bones. It's important to understand that human beings everywhere are wired to respond to stories. You can't just throw facts and figures at people and expect them to be blown away. You need to tie everything together in a way that has forward movement and emotional power. We'll teach you how to do that. Delivering your pitch. Some startup founders come from an engineering background. Some come from product development or the IT department. Some were line chefs who made it big. Others were history majors who lucked into a financial job. In other words, you may not have much experience delivering a pitch tailored for each audience you address, answering questions which may be forceful, on the fly, or dealing with the inevitable rejection you'll encounter. For some, making the pitch is one of the scariest parts of being a founder. But it doesn't have to be. We'll tell you exactly how to prepare and practice so that you become completely at ease. Learning to listen. Communication is a two-way street. You need to be open to what the market is telling you. We don't mean how to give people the impression that you're listening when you're really planning your next step. No. We mean you really need to develop the capacity to accept feedback, especially from people who like much of what you have to say, but tell you no anyway. Believe us, we speak from experience. Closing the deal. Okay, you found an investor, made your pitch, perhaps several times, gone over preliminaries. You may even have a handshake deal. But always remember the old expression, a deal isn't done until the ink is dry. What are those final finishing touches you need to move from agreement in principle to money in the bank? Let's explore. Building to win. Building a business is hard. It's not for everyone. As an entrepreneur, you are the captain of your own ship. You will look at working for others differently. You will understand how to act decisively and without malice or confusion. And you will also come to appreciate the freedom of building your own business in a very real sense. No one can take that away from you. In fact, you may become spoiled. The entrepreneurial life is very exciting, and the up-and-down thrill of building, failing, and building again is addictive. And within that lies another problem. Your failures will probably outnumber your successes. What happens then is a deeply dangerous period of self-doubt. Entrepreneurs are often highly ambitious and are used to winning. Odds are that you will lose, and perhaps lose spectacularly. The end game for the entrepreneur is growth. It's change. It's a refusal to give up. It's also an understanding that your idea might not be good enough, that being an entrepreneur won't make you enough cash to survive, and is therefore a drain. And you might break yourself or something you love to try to meet your goal. The entrepreneur's ultimate goal is to fix something that's broken. All great businesses start with that premise. If you're building something just to make money, or if your expectations are out of whack, you will ultimately lose. In a sense, this whole book is a meditation on that idea. By learning to think clearly about funding, you will learn to think more deeply and more clearly about your goals and dreams, about why you're starting a business in the first place. How to listen to this book. Too many businesses fail because they lack financial resources. There is a vital difference between financial resources and material resources. You can have an enviable collection of comic books to sell, a warehouse full of hamburger buns, or a complete set of dog grooming tools. If you want to grow past a single-person business, you need financial resources to put those material resources to work. Getting funded shouldn't be just an afterthought. It should be your first thought. Even as you sling your first comics at a flea market, fry up your first burgers for friends, or shave your first shih tzu. To do more, you need financial resources. This book is about how to get those resources as quickly and as painlessly as possible. This book is broken into three parts. Part 1, Startup Funding Basics, contains an overview of the types of funding available to founders of new businesses and explains key concepts, such as valuation and dilution, that you need to understand before you decide on a strategy. Part 2, Finding the Right Funding Model for Your Business, explains the criteria you should use and the process you should follow to devise your preferred funding plan. Part 3, Communicating Your Story, contains a series of exercises that will help you better pitch your story to investors. This includes the terrifying startup monster, the pitch, as well as basic advice most seasoned entrepreneurs had wished they had known before starting their businesses. Let's get started. Part 1. Startup Funding Basics. The goal of an early-stage startup is to survive and become an actual business. Many founders believe that getting funded is the primary goal. It's not. The founder's real goal is to create a business that makes money for herself and her investors. There are many competing views on when to raise startup funding, but most investors won't look at a project until it is a real, cash flow positive business. In part one, we'll explore everything you need to understand regarding funding. Chapter 1. What is a startup? A startup is a small business with global ambitions. This is the simplest way to describe anything from a taco truck to a software as a solution, SaaS, service, for e-commerce funnel growth. If you're building a business, your goal should be to grow it as big as possible. But this doesn't mean every hot dog stand has to be part of an organization that is as big as McDonald's. Your goal is to find a blend of value, quality, and growth that allows you and your business to thrive. Some businesses will hit the Goldilocks point where everything is just right, but not much is growing. But at some point, fundraising may become an important part of growth. An entrepreneur is a scientist. Your goal is to test a hypothesis. Your app or restaurant or store is a hypothesis testing machine. You think that people will want what you are selling. In order to test this hypothesis, you must be as pragmatic as possible and produce results that prove, without a doubt, that you are on the right track. First, the bad news. Startups fail. A lot. Before discussing funding, it makes sense to explore some of the statistics associated with startups. According to Small Business Trends, a bit more than half of all startups actually survive to their fourth year, while the startup failure rate at 4 years is about 44%. Fast forward 2 more years, and 56% of startups have failed. Statisticians estimate that 90% of all startups ultimately fail, which means they don't stick around to gather growth funding, go global, or get bought. Some startups barely get past the domain name registration stage. Many won't make it off the ketchup-stained napkin after a brainstorm. And even more die in our heads as we get more and more frustrated by the realities of building a business. Startups fail all the time, and often it's no one's fault. Timing, trendiness, and luck often factor into the failure of a business as much as skill, experience, and cash. The original Ben and Jerry hit a wall trying to sell ice cream in the middle of a Vermont winter, a decidedly inauspicious way to begin. They began their business in May 1978 with $12,000 in seed money. They sold ice cream during the summer, but the business suffered from October to February. Faced with failure, they created Free Cone Day the next May to remind their summer customers why they loved the brand in the first place. The result? A huge uptick in sales all summer, and, thanks to the founder's very unusual ice cream-making style, people kept coming back for the shop's secret sauce. In fact, Ben & Jerry's succeeded only because one founder, Ben Cohen, had severe agnosia. That meant he had no sense of smell and nearly no ability to taste food. Because of this, he found texture to be of the utmost importance, and he discovered how to mix huge chunks of chocolate or fruit into the ice cream in order to satisfy himself. In an era when it was far easier and cheaper to mix in syrups or tiny pieces of chocolate, Ben and Jerry's was a mouth-watering experience. But if they had not nearly failed during their first winter and learned from that experience, they would never have succeeded. Why things fail. According to Small Business Trends, the top 10 causes of small business failures are, in order of prevalence, the following. 1. Lack of product-to-market fit. 2. Running out of cash. 3. Team problems. 4. Competition. 5. Pricing and/or cost issues. 6. User experience problems. 7. No business model. 8. Poor marketing. 9. Bad customer communication. 10. Market timing. Product and/or market fit, as we see, is the most important part of a business. Product and/or market fit happens when what you've built is in heavy demand. Ben and Jerry's owned one of the few ice cream parlors in Burlington, Vermont. This meant that their audience, hungry college students, was almost captive. Now imagine the same situation in a place like New York or Chicago. Not quite the same. In Burlington, the product and/or market fit was local. And then, when the rest of the world discovered the value of their ice cream, the product and/or market fit went global. Finally, 40% of small businesses are profitable, 30% break even, and 30% lose money over time. Often entrepreneurs keep going long after it's time to quit. We're offering this list not to scare you, but to create realistic expectations. Ignoring the serious challenges that await you is a plan for failure. You and your team must be extremely vigilant to avoid any of the pitfalls we mentioned as you move through the process of building your business. Not everyone can be a Michael Dell, who started his global empire by hand-building computers in his garage, which eventually led to his building a billion-dollar company. The truth is that the early-stage visionary with the big idea isn't always the right person to run the day-to-day aspects of a business. Investors aren't going to look at just your strengths. They're also going to determine whether you can see your own blind spots. Our goal is to help you see those blind spots before anyone else does. The good news. Now that we've brought you down with the scary statistics, we have some really good news. You're an entrepreneur. That's amazing! You are building a startup. You have a great idea. The will to create something. And an understanding of your market that no one else has. You have the guts to take risks, to hunt down capital, and to build something people want to use. And you are experiencing the deep joy that comes with creating something bigger than yourself. Sure, not all of this might be true yet, but let us assure you, it will be. Eventually, you're going to look back and appreciate these efforts in a unique and joyful way, and you'll be happy you took the risks. Look at the flip side of the most pessimistic statistic we offered. If 90% of startups fail, then 10% of startups survive. Of course, the odds are against you, so what? You have a fighting chance of making something that you can be proud of. Further, remember the simple adage, we learn from failure. Even if you don't break through to the other side, your experience is invaluable. The bottom line is that you should think of building your business as a continuum. Perhaps your first idea wasn't quite the winner. Your next one will be better. And your next one. And your next one after that. building a startup is a surprisingly rewarding experience. Would you rather be in a cubicle working for someone else? Or would you rather work on your own terms, at your own pace, and for your own benefit? For entrepreneurs, the choice is abundantly clear. Chapter 2. Funding Options. This chapter is our Startup Funding 101 Introductory Course. You may find the discussion a bit elementary, but bear with us. We're establishing a framework for the discussion that follows in the rest of the book. First, let's explore the different kinds of funding available to entrepreneurs. Debt versus equity versus a middle ground. The perfect company doesn't need investment. The perfect company doesn't exist. Therefore, at some point, you'll be walking the halls at investor haunts in Silicon Valley or knocking on your banker's door. But what are your options? What should you ask for? Let's explore the various mixes of debt and equity that are available to modern entrepreneurs. Debt. Debt funding is, quite simply, a loan. Loans come from many sources, including friends and family, F&F, government agencies like the Small Business Administration, SBA, banks, and private investors. A debt can be secured by some kind of collateral. A car is collateral when you take out a car loan, or unsecured, in which the only thing the investor gets is a note, that is, your legally binding promise to repay. Many entrepreneurs like the idea of funding their startup with debt because they believe they're not giving up any ownership in the business. But as we'll see, things aren't always that simple. In fact, they seldom are. There are a number of methods used by investors to offer loans, including convertible notes, that is, loans that can be converted to equity under certain conditions. Such notes allow entrepreneurs to default and potentially fail without facing undue pressure. In many countries, however, debt funding is quite difficult to acquire, simply because the investors are risk-averse or the legal system does not allow debt funding that can collapse into bankruptcy. Debt isn't a bad word. Many of the funding options we describe in this book involve debt instruments. You should be ready to take on some debt as you grow your business, but you also need to be prepared to face the consequences should you be unable to pay back a loan. In most funding scenarios, even with loans that are nominally unsecured, you should consider cash received as a loan with part of your company as collateral. For every dollar you receive, you give up a little more of your freedom. Equity. Equity means ownership. People who have an equity stake in your business own part of it. Equity funding allows you to sell part of your business to an investor. Because it's not a loan, you don't have to worry about repaying it. However, granting equity turns the investor into the equivalent of a co-founder early on. A co-founder whose only input is usually cash, that is, not work. Because of this, you must be certain that the investor is someone you want on your team. If you own your business outright and sell part of it to an investor, by definition, you will then own less of it. You started out owning 100% of your business, and now you own less than 100%. The more investors you take on, and the more their terms of investment vary, the more complex the matter of dilution becomes. We devote all of Chapter 7 to this concept. Equity investments require your company to exist outside of the idea stage. Equity investors usually want access to your technology, your profit stream, and your team. equity investors could also resell their shares to someone else, or could, in theory, purchase your entire company. A good equity investor is solid gold. A bad equity investor is a time bomb. Good equity investors want to help you grow, or at least want to stay out of your way. Bad equity investors are vocal about your failures and expect you to treat their every thought as solid gold. Investors who force you to listen to them rather than offer advice are toxic to an organization because, in short, they become the CEO for the CEO. The resulting dichotomy can sink your company. Equity investors should want to be part of your organization. Choose them as carefully as you'd choose a date or even a life partner. A good investor can change your world. A bad one can ruin it. The middle ground. You should not be afraid of mixing debt and equity over time. Focusing on one funding type, convertible notes, say, while avoiding dilution through an equity sale, is a surefire way to end up without cash in the long run. Some investors want to offer loans. Some want part of your business. Still others are happy just to help. Finding a mix of those types of investors is imperative. A new universe of funding models. In traditional finance, there's debt, there's equity, and there are blends of debt and equity. That's it. That's the entire universe of funding. But in the new age of universal internet, cryptocurrencies, community-supported ventures, and the like, there are other ways to access funds, ways that involve neither debt nor equity. Powered by new entities such as Kickstarter, Indiegogo, Patreon, and GoFundMe, new fundraising methods offer a sense of belonging, participation, and fun in exchange for money. And it works, to the tune of billions of dollars per year. Entirely new financial models based on blockchain and cryptocurrency technologies are revolutionizing early-stage funding, bringing with them a whole new language. We'll explore all of these avenues and help you figure out which path is best for you. Microfunding versus macrofunding. To simplify the discussion, we're introducing the terms microfunding and macrofunding, which we will discuss in greater depth in chapters 4 and 5. For now, some definitions. Microfunding includes bootstrapping, gifts or loans from friends and family, F&F, and crowdfunding through Patreon, GoFundMe, Kickstarter, or some other source. Macrofunding includes loans and grants, plus any kind of equity stake and/or big commitment, including angel investors, venture capitalists, VCs, accelerators or cauldrons, and cryptocurrency sources like initial coin offerings, ICOs, and initial exchange offerings, IEOs. Depending on where you're starting and where you're hoping to go, you may approach the rest of this book in any of several ways. If you're in a microfunding situation, you don't need to worry about valuations and dilution and how to pitch to VCs. But you may have to worry about how to make a successful Kickstarter video or how to market a Patreon launch. Although some startups have used platforms like Kickstarter to raise millions, they're typically used to raise smaller amounts. They don't offer debt or equity, but only premium rewards or future products. Many such arrangements are informal, based solely on good faith. If you're in a macro funding situation, on the other hand, your world is much more formal. You'll be signing contracts, some of them quite complicated. You'll need to worry about valuations and dilution, your deck, how to prepare and practice your pitch and your body language and all that other good stuff. In addition, you'll also need to be aware of all kinds of hazards that could wind up costing you your business. So on top of everything else, you'd better make sure you have a lawyer you trust to advise you before you sign anything. Of course, many companies make the transition from micro to macro. Airbnb and Little Baby's Ice Cream are good examples, both of which we describe in later chapters. Chapter 3. Stages of Traditional Funding. Funding comes in stages. Understanding these will help you know when and where to go for funding at each stage of your business. Further, it will help you communicate with funders more precisely. What you think when you hear seed funding and A rounds might be different from what investors think. You both need to be on the same page as you move forward. Early money stage. The first stage is early money, when cash is invested in exchange for large amounts of equity. This cash, which ranges between $1,000 and $500,000, typically comes from the three Fs: friends, family, and, we don't like this nomenclature, fools. The last-named folks are essentially giving you cash, and these investors are well aware that you will most likely fail, hence, fools. Your earliest investors should reap the biggest rewards because they are taking the most risk. The assumption is that, ultimately, you'll make good or improve their investment. The reality, they understand, is that you probably won't. Your first money may come from bootstrapping or F&F, and your first big checks may come from an accelerator that pays you about $50,000 for a fairly large stake in your company. Accelerators are essentially greenhouses or incubators for startups. You apply to them. If accepted, you get assistance and a small amount of funding. Why do investors give early money? Because they trust you. They understand your industry, and they believe you can succeed. Some are curious about what you are doing and want to be close to the action. Others want to lock you up in case you are successful. In fact, many accelerators have this in mind when they connect with new startups. At its core, the funding landscape is surprisingly narrow. When you begin fundraising, you'll hear a lot of terminology, including descriptions of various funding categories and investors. Let's talk about them one by one. Bootstrapping. As the old saying goes, if you need a helping hand, you'll find it at the end of your arm. With that adage in mind, let's begin with bootstrapping. Bootstrapping comes from the concept of pulling yourself up by your own bootstraps, a comical image that computer scientists adopted to describe how a computer starts from a powered-down state. In the case of an entrepreneur, bootstrapping is synonymous with sweat equity, your own work and money that you put into your business without outside help. Bootstrapping is often the only way to begin a business as an entrepreneur. By bootstrapping, you will find out very quickly how invested you are, personally, in your idea. Bootstrapping requires you to spend money or resources on yourself. It means you either spend your own cash to build an early version of your product, or you build the product yourself, using your own skills and experience. In the case of service businesses, IT shops, design houses, and so on, it requires you to quit your day job and invest full-time in your own business. Bootstrapping should be a finite action. For example, you should plan to bootstrap for a year or less and plan to spend a certain amount of money bootstrapping. If you blow past your time or money budget with little to show for your efforts, you should probably scrap the idea. Some ideas take very little cash to bootstrap. These businesses require sweat equity, that is, your own work on a project that leads to at least a minimum viable product, MVP. Consider an entrepreneur who wants to build a new app-based business in which users pay or will pay for access to a service. Very basic Apple iOS and Google Android applications cost about $25,000 to build, and they can take up to 6 months to design and implement. You could also create a simpler, web-based version of the application as a bootstrapping effort, which often takes far less cash, about $5,000 at $50 an hour. You can also teach yourself to code and build your MVP yourself. This is often how tech businesses begin, and it says plenty about the need for founders to code, or at least be proficient in the technical aspects of their business. You can't bootstrap forever. One entrepreneur we encountered was building a dating app. She had dedicated her life to this dating app, spending all of her money, quitting her job to continue to build it. She slept on couches and told everyone she knew about the app, networking to within an inch of her life. Years later, it was a dead app in an app store containing millions of dead apps. While this behavior might get results 1 in 1,000 times, few entrepreneurs can survive for a year of app-induced penury, let alone multiple years. Another entrepreneur we knew was focused on nanotubes. He spent years rushing here and there.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.